population genetic inferences like population structure and demography. In turn, we now have multiple insights about the mitochondria. For instance, we know that they are usually inherited uniparently. The mitochondria undergo recombination in plants and fungi, but not in animals. The mutation rate in mitochondria is 10 to 25 times higher than that in the nucleus in animals, but much lower than the nuclear mutation rate in plants. So a lot is known about mitochondria in plants and animals, but we lack most such understanding in unicellular eukaryotes. So unicellular organisms actually span all the eukaryotic kingdoms and comprise of most of the phylogenetic diversity, but are usually heavily understudied. And also have a variety of mitochondrial genome structures. So of course, usually we think of mitochondria as the monomorphic linear molecule that's present in animals and plants, much larger. But they range all the way from very tiny circular chromosomes in Neglaria and Rubrae, that's an excavate, to very tiny linear chromosomes, and also to like to much larger monomeric linear chromosomes in ciliates that are part of algaloids. So we aim to characterize the population genetic environment of mitochondria in Paramecium, which is a genus that is a ciliate. Part of the ciliates. So we actually have we sequenced and assembled 13 mitochondrial genomes from within Paramecium, and this green plate that you see over here, this is referred to as the Paramecium Aurelia complex, which has actually undergone two whole genome duplications here in the nucleus, not in the mitochondria. And they look completely morphologically identical. And we also have about 5 to 13 isolates from about 4 different species, Gaudium, Multimicronucleatum, Sexoralia, and Tetraralia, for which we mapped to the reference genomes and detected SNPs. So in accordance to the fact that most of these species are extremely similar morphologically, we found that their mitochondrial genomes are also highly syntonic, have exactly the same protein coding content, and basically very similar total sizes. And this is sort of interesting because they're highly diverged. Like they go back to about 320 million years ago, approximately. So it is a bit surprising that there are not many changes. And one of the unique features of these genomes is about 16 lineage-specific genes that have no known homologs in any of the other eukaryotic mitochondrial genes. So this is the Paramecium Sexoralia genome, and all the green regions show you those lineage-specific genes that also happen to be very rapidly evolving, as can be seen by the DNDS values in comparison to the other protein-coding genes and the ribosome genes. But for this talk, I would like to talk about two things. One is the nucleotide composition and mutation spectrum in mitochondria, and the recombination and efficacy of pure fine selection in mitochondria. So we know that mitochondrial genomes have immensely different nucleotide composition. So characterized by GC content, you know that GC content can be as low as like 10% and as high as like 65%. But most of them usually are 80 rich. In Paramecium, they seem to have undergone a nucleotide content change. So there's been an increase in the GC content in the Paramecium, like in the branch that leads to the Paramecium Aurelia complex. And there has been no similar change in the nuclear genomes. And what we see is that when we look at this, when we look at four-fold degenerate sites, they enhance these differences in GC content. So going, the outer groups have as low as something like 4 to 7% GC content, but the Aurelias have as high as 50% GC content in the four-fold degenerate sites. So this suggests that maybe this is because of either neutral processes like mutation or possibly because of selection for codon usage bias. But I mean, if selection for codon usage bias was the main reason for changes in GC content, you shouldn't see this in intergenic and tRNA regions. So when we do look at intergenic and tRNA genes, we continue to find this shift in GC content, suggesting that perhaps mutation is playing a role in these changes in GC content. So in order to understand more about mutation, we looked at the mutation spectrum that was observed in mutation accumulation lines done for paramecium tetraradia here for the mitochondrial DNA. And we also tried to estimate the mutation spectrum from population genomic data that we have for four of these species. So there are two quantities of interest here. One of them is the AT bias, which is basically the ratio of mutation rate from GC to AT by rate from AT to GC. And then we looked at the expected equilibrium GC content that is to be predicted under mutation alone. So when we look at the study that has already been published in 2012, which was a mutation accumulation study in paramecium tetraradia, we find that the AT bias is very close to one, and the equilibrium GC content is predicted to be about 53%, which is very close to the four-fold degenerate site content. And we get very similar values from population genomic data, where we used four-fold singletons at four-fold degenerate sites to estimate the mutation spectrum. And we similarly find that the AT bias is relatively close to one. On the other hand, when we look at paramecium car data, we find that we estimate the AT bias to be much higher. So one question here is whether is what you usually find in the mitochondria, like what kind of mutation spectrum do you usually find in the mitochondria? So I also looked at previously done mutation accumulation studies from other species, and I just calculated the same values for those, and what we find, like, we see two really interesting things. That it seems like the mutation bias can be entirely GC biased, or it can be entirely AT biased, like very strongly GC or AT biased. And also that closely related species can have different AT biases, suggesting that it is possible for the AT bias to have decreased along the paramecium or radial lineage. So next, I would like to talk about recombination and efficacy of pure fan selection. So this is interesting because we know that when paramecia have sex, they exchange their micronuclear DNA, but it was not clear if they exchanged their mitochondrial DNA. So we try to look at the population data to test for presence of recombination. So this can be done in various ways. And what we did is, so first we calculated linkage disequilibrium between pairs of sites with some distance d. And usually we just use the standard statistic, R squared, that is used to do that. Where p here is the allele frequency of that particular allele. And usually, if it's a recombining genome, your linkage disequilibrium should decay with respect to this distance between sites. We failed to find any decrease in LD as with distance, so that suggests an absence of recombination. We also did a four-gamma test, which where the idea is basically that if you assume the infinite sites mutation model, then if you find at a pair of sites, if you find all four gametes segregating, then that must be because of recombination. And and the idea is that as the distance between these pairs of sites increases, there should be a higher probability of observing these four gametes. And again, we do not find such a relationship, so we think that it suggests absence of recombination. Lastly, if your infinite site model is violated, recurrent mutations can also look like recombination. So programs like LD-HAT can take care of that and then estimate a recombination rate for you. And so we did that, and for all four species, we estimated recombination rate is zero. So yeah, there's no recombination in families in mitochondria. Okay. So but then the question becomes, like the speaker before me also just said, is so what about the efficacy of selection? So does this, I mean, if there's no recombination in the mitochondria, is the efficacy of selection lower than the nucleus? I mean, these are partially asexual species, so we know that the recombination mitochondria in the nucleus is also lower, but still. So we asked that question next. So first thing we did is we looked at DNDS across the phylogeny for both the mitochondrial and the nuclear genes, and we actually don't find any significant difference between the DNDS, suggesting that there isn't any difference. Then we looked at the ratio of non-synonymous to synonymous diversity for all of these four species, for mitochondria and nucleus separately. And in that case, we find some difference. So what we then find is that two of the species, Tetrabrevia and Quadrivium, have no differences, but that Sexagrevia and Multimicronucleatum have lower prime bias values, suggesting a stronger pure prime selection. So then we also looked at another statistic called the neutrality index, because that's usually used to look at this efficacy of selection, and which is usually determined by number of polymorphisms by fixed differences in non-synonymous versus synonymous sites. And usually, if the idea is that the neutrality index is one under strict neutrality, where mutations are neutral or strongly deleterious. And if your Ni is greater than 1, it indicates slightly deleterious polymorphisms. If Ni is less than 1, it usually indicates positive selection. So we did this for we did this for three species, because one of the species didn't have enough polymorphism data, actually. And what we find, consistent with earlier results, is that in Tetrabrevia and Quadrivium, there's no significant difference in the neutrality index values, but that in Sexagrevia, there's a significant difference. In order to reduce the synonymous site saturation biases, we also had to do a number of different variations of the neutrality index, including one which we calculated by bi-N bias by pairwise DNDS for more closely related species, so which we could only do for two of them. And again, though consistently, we find that Tetrabrevia has no difference in neutrality index values, but in Sexagrevia there is a significant difference. But here, the nucleus has more deleterious polymorphisms segregating. So it seems again that mitochondria is under stronger pure prime selection. Even though the mitochondria, it has no recombination, it seems like it's under a stronger pure prime selection. One reason for this that has been proposed is a difference in distribution of fitness effects. But I think we also have to be careful, because this is it's not exactly fair comparison, because a lot of the genes in the mitochondria are highly conserved, like all eukaryotes. And so I think these results have to be interpreted with a little caution. Despite that, the main conclusions are that for paramecium mitochondrial genomes, they're highly conserved across very highly diverse species. The GC content changes seem to be because of mutation, and the mitochondria seem to experience either similar or stronger pure prime selection than the nucleus.
So we just